Smoke Break MMA is back in your life today with a repeat guest, one of my favorite guests to have on because this man knows his MMA just like I do, John Sloan.
Thanks very much for having me, mate. It's a pleasure to be back on the Smoke Break MMA podcast. I've been seeing the episodes you've been firing out, and you've had some really good guests, some really interesting watches. James Lynch was a particular favourite of mine. But great episodes, and it's a pleasure to be back on.
Oh, yeah. I'm trying to reach out a little bit. You know Ty O'Keefe, right? The MMA Ty O'Keefe on Twitter?
No.
You should definitely look him up. I'll tweet you after. He's another MMA. He's got an MMA podcast, and he's very, very good. And we've been doing a lot of stuff together. But more to come. You know, more. I'm trying to branch out, trying to get bigger guests, bigger names, just like yourself. You know, I didn't like to do many interviews, but now I just pump them out like crazy.
Yeah, I saw you did one with, is it Nick Baldwin? He's someone I hadn't actually heard of before he went on your podcast, but I went and checked out some of his work after, and he's quite good as well.
Oh yeah, I had Nick Baldwin on, and actually, I think I had the same guest on that you had once, Fabian Edwards.
Oh, you had Fabian on, yeah. He's a cool guy. He's got a big fight coming up at Bellator 215.
Yep, I had him on just a couple of episodes ago, and I predict within 3 years, by 2021, I believe he'll be the Bellator middleweight champion.
Yeah, I totally agree with that analysis. Yeah, he's going to be an absolute superstar.
He said within 1 year, but of course that's what he thinks. I said within three. Within 3 years, he'll be champion.
To be fair, I don't think it'll take him too long, to be fair, because if he beats Lee Chadwick at Bellator or Newcastle and then gets Mike Shipman, if he gets those two victories, two stoppages, both early stoppages, like he's saying, if he gets both of those wins and he's only realistically one win away from a title shot, he's fighting in February, which means it's realistic to get four fights in next year. So, like, I don't think his timescale is stupid by any means. I honestly believe he could be Bellator middleweight champion by this time next year.
Yeah, I mean, it depends. Like you said, I talked to him about that. At Bellator, it seems you can get in title contention quicker. Like in the UFC,
you
can win 8 fights in a row. Like Usman or, you know, a Leon Edwards, I believe, has 7 fight win streak. His brother.
Yeah.
I didn't know that was his brother until he told me that.
I
should have put 2 and 2 together because, you know, same last name, they look similar, but I had no...
Yeah, they have. There's a big resemblance there. Fabian's just a bit bigger.
He surprised me, though, when he said that, but in Bellator, you can definitely reel off 4 wins opposed to 8 or 9 in the UFC, and you're right there.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean,
his highlights,
you know,
James
Gallagher, I mean, he's an Irish guy. Before he lost to Ricky Banderas at Bellator 204, I think it was. Before he lost to Ricky Banderas there, he was promised a title shot. And at that time, you know, he was only 8-0 and he'd had 4 wins in Bellator. So yeah, I think you're right. 3 to 4 wins. And if you bring with that a large following and stylistically an exciting style to watch that's fan-friendly and the promotion like, especially if you talk yourself up to, like, Fabian, he's quite aspirational. He's always talking about what's next. He's always looking beyond the next fight, and I think that's something that Bellator will really buy into.
Yeah, he's a good talker, and if you look up this guy's highlight reel, I mean, he is a killer.
Yeah. I'm not sure if you have him on Facebook, but he released a promo for the Lee Chadwick fight. I don't know who made it, but I'm assuming it's just someone that's in his own circle. But anyway, that just pretty much had all his finishes from amateur going into pro. And yeah, scary. I mean, flying knees going backwards, the lot.
Punches, rear naked chokes. He's got some submissions. He's dangerous. He's definitely one to look out for. And, you know, mentioning James real quick, just to touch on it, I still believe James will be champion. Do you still believe James is going to be a world champion?
Oh, 100%. I mean, James is only a couple of years older than me. You know, he's only 21 years of age. I mean, the fact that he's got 8-0 against the level of opponents that he's beaten is quite unbelievable. I mean, who did he beat at featherweight before he beat Banderas? I think he beat Chinzo Machida.
And Chinzo is little brother, who is no joke.
Yeah, 100%, he's no joke, you know. It was actually, I think I watched one of James' interviews after, and he was saying that, you know, the Machidas, that was the style he kind of looked up to when he was developing his striking, because, you know, they were just absolutely destroying everyone when he was growing up. So, yeah, the fact that he can defeat someone like that at 19, you know, he's going to be a world champion at some point in his career. Maybe not at bantamweight, but we might get into that on a different episode, but I definitely believe that he'll be a champion at some point in his life.
Yeah, definitely. I believe featherweight too, but he's mentioned his last interview that he's going to fight at bantamweight until he can't make that weight no more. But
yeah, but that being said, he is only 21. I mean, I think he only has a couple more years. You know, you see it all the time with fighters. When they get to about 24, 25, they just balloon up and they normally go through a phase where they miss weight a couple of times, and then the promotion says to them, look, you need to buckle up.
And he actually said in his last interview with Ariel, I believe it was his last interview, that he was going to fight in December. Well, December's over and he still didn't fight. I wonder if there's a reason for that.
The reason for that is that Bellator had originally targeted Dublin, his hometown, for a card in December. There were some problems getting a date at the Three Arena in Dublin, so they had to put that forward to February. He was offered a fight in between, but he said that he'd rather wait till February just so he's not injury prone for fighting in Ireland, because that's been a dream of his for a long time.
Is it going to be against Ricky, or is that going to be later down the line?
No, he's got an opponent announced. His opponent is, I think he's 6-3 is his pro record, and I've actually got an interview arranged with him next week, so I better not forget his name. his name is Stephen Graham, but yeah, what's interesting about him is I had a little watch of a few of his fights on YouTube, and he's a guy who's really, really instinctive on the ground. You know, he's a high level at jiu-jitsu. I think he's a brown belt, and he comes from a really good gym full of high level grapplers. And that's quite interesting because, you know, we've seen James against so many elite strikers just impose his grappling game, but we haven't seen him as an elite grappler against an elite grappler. So yeah, I'll be really interested to see that, because I think that'll be the real big test on how good Gallagher's ground game really is.
Yeah, he's a wizard on the ground. Gallagher is a wizard on the ground. But tonight, UFC, John Jones, Gustafson, Nunes, Cyborg. There's actually some sleepers on the card too. We got BJ Penn, Ryan Hall, Uriah Hall is on this card. Yeah. Megan Anderson and Kat Zingano.
Can I just say that the Megan Anderson and the Kat Zingano stare down at the ceremonial weigh-ins was probably one of the most intense women's stare downs I've ever seen. Oh, and yeah. I didn't expect it to be.
Kat is scary. Like, if you... Kat Zingano is a scary woman.
Yeah, it's totally. But I've actually got Megan in that one.
I disagree with you. I see where you're going, but I refer back to the Holly Holm fight, and that was kind of bullshit. They threw Megan Holly, her first fight, like that's yeah. hard to debut against yeah. Holly Holm. And
yeah, well, do you mean the fact that, are you trying to say that the fact that she was out grappled by Holly Holm, a striker, suggests that Kat Zingano is going to have an easy time with her?
I'm saying that Kat Zingano, I'm saying if Holly Holm can hold her down, and Holly's not normally a grappler, Holly's a kickboxer, if Holly can yeah. hold you down, I'm pretty sure Kat has, if not the same grappling, we'll say Kat and Holly have the same wrestling ability. I believe Kat Zingano is going to have the wrestling advantage, definitely.
Yeah, I agree. But the only reason I go for Megan is I was actually watching her fights back in Invicta on UFC Fight Pass last week. And I noticed that she does really well with people that have the same kind of height and build as Kat Zingano. You know, she does a really good job of kind of holding range and dictating the pace. She uses leg kicks and a long jab really well to kind of stop grapplers closing the distance. So I've actually got her by decision. And going back to that Holly Holm fight, I think we're forgetting that, you know, for the 2 or 3, 4 minutes that fight was on the feet,
Megan Anderson
was piecing Holly up. Like, there was a few times where she actually looked hurt.
Yeah, she blasted her with a knee right down the middle and stunned her. But yeah. You get what I'm saying, though. If
yeah, totally. That's an exciting fight, though. I'd say on the prelims, that's probably the fight that I'm most looking forward to.
Yeah, and BJ Penn. BJ Penn has been knocked out.
He shouldn't be fighting.
He's been decisioned.
It's like Chuck Liddell, he should not be fighting. He needs to retire.
He's been decisioned, but he's never been submitted. BJ Penn, through his UFC career, has never been submitted. It will break my heart if Ryan Hall, who is a great Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt, I believe, a black belt, he's definitely a high level. And that's what they gave BJ Ryan, because Ryan's not going to beat you up. He's not going to outstrike you. He's a grappler. In my opinion, and just hear me out, I think BJ is going to win. I think BJ is going to win. He's going to lay those gloves down in the middle octagon, and he's going to walk away with a W.
That's interesting. Nah, I've got to say, I'm going with Ryan Hall on this one. I think he gets it done. I think he gets it done via unanimous decision. And BJ Penn, you know, what really, really gave BJ Penn the edge, and George St. Pierre's talked about this, was his reflexes that he had back in the day. You know, he was always first at absolutely everything. And he's kind of lost that in the last couple of years. Like, you know, what was it? The fight where I really thought BJ Penn needs to retire is when, do you remember when he fought Dennis Siver?
Yeah, it was a majority decision. It was super close, though.
Yeah, it was close, but that's, but I, you know, prime BJ Penn should be smashing Dennis Siver all day long. It was when I saw that fight, I was like, we're just never going to see the same BJ Penn in ever again. And you don't want to get to that stage where, you don't want to get to that stage where you're kind of, your legacy is tainted because you didn't know when to retire. You've got to kind of go out with some dignity.
But is it really tainted? In my opinion, and a lot, BJ Penn is still top 10 of all time. He's got to be. He's still in everybody's top 10. He's the, back when he fought Diego Sanchez, when he fought Joe Stevenson, he was a monster. He was, he, when you think of a 155 king overall, I'm talking the entire UFC history from whenever the lightweight division was started to now, other than Khabib, it's probably BJ Penn. You know, BJ Penn was a dominant lightweight up until he met Frankie Edgar.
Yeah, totally. I just think that there's these guys that could be remembered a lot better if they just hung up the gloves, you know, when they were up to beat. Another guy, kind of guy that fits into that category is Gray Maynard. He should not be fighting anymore either. Who did he just lose to? Nick Lentz. He got absolutely demolished by Nick Lentz. Like, I just don't think these guys should be fighting this far past their prime. It's a bad health choice as well. Like, how many times are these guys going to get knocked out but before they begin to realise, like, it's but I suppose they're coming from a different era financially, so some of them, you know, some of them might still need to fight financially.
I believe that it's going to be straight jiu-jitsu match like we know, and I believe BJ's going to catch him. I think BJ's going to catch him with a rear naked choke, or I believe BJ's going to win by submission, and if he does, that would be the quintessential perfect ending. Win by submission, lay your gloves down, get a standing ovation, and leave with a win. That, like, if that happens, if BJ wins, and if he wins, he should retire, and I'm pretty sure everybody thinks he will if he gets the win or lose, but that's
interesting. I was watching an interview earlier this week from BJ Penn, and this interview was back in May, and BJ Penn said that he still thought he had 2 or 3 years left of fighting in him.
But maybe not with the UFC. This might be his last
one. Yeah. Good point. You might head over to Golden Boy MMA and see what they can offer him.
But he's win or lose, and no matter if he loses 20 straight, he's still a legend in MMA.
Debatable.
Not did BJ Penn not a legend?
I just think you need to go out when you're at the top, and I think that that takes a lot of skill. You know, like GSP. You know, in my opinion, GSP is the greatest fighter to ever do it. And as a big GSP fan, I don't want to see GSP back because he's done everything he needs to do. You know, he's defended the welterweight belt many times against many killers. Went up a weight class, defeated, you know, one of the most underrated champions in UFC history, Michael Bisping, by stoppage, something that's very hard to do. I'd be quite happy, you know, he doesn't need to fight till he's 42 or 43, and he knows that, you know. People are always going to be remembered. People are always going to remember you by the kind of the way you went out, and especially the younger generation of fans, you know, like me. I'm 19 years old, you know. When BJ Penn was in his prime, you know, I was probably just beginning to watch the UFC as a very young man. So the memories I have of BJ Penn aren't the same memories that people like yourself may have of BJ Penn. So I think he needs to take that into consideration. But yeah, I suppose I just wouldn't say top 10 greatest, I've got to be honest.
I didn't
watch through the generation. I've went back and watched his career chronologically after, you know. I wasn't there in the moment to analyse every little detail of his opponents and which threats they posed. Not top 10 for me.
So another really close, really hard fight to pick is Carlos Condit and Chiesa. Chiesa going up to 170. And yesterday when they faced off, Michael Chiesa is fucking bigger than Condit, and how the hell did Michael Chiesa ever make 155, we'll never know, but like when they stood face to face, Chiesa was bigger and had bigger arms and a bigger chest than Carlos Condit, who's a natural 170.
Yeah, well, it'll be really interesting to see how Chiesa does. Chiesa's one of those guys who, on his day, you know, can beat anyone. Could have beaten anyone in the lightweight division, in my opinion, and could be anyone in the welterweight division if he shows up. I do really rate his skill set. It's just the inconsistency, and the question that we need to kind of ask is, inconsistency down to mismanaged weight cuts? And will we see a better, more consistent version of Michael Chiesa? And we'll find that out tonight. But seriously, you know, I believe if the Michael Chiesa that we have seen before shows up tonight and puts on a dominant performance over Carlos Condit, you know, I think he's a very tough matchup for anyone in that welterweight division. He's very awkward to fight.
But then again, you can never sleep on Condit. Carlos Condit is the former interim welterweight champ. He beat Nick Diaz. He took George St. Pierre to the end. You know, they went to a decision and George was
knocked out Dan Hardy.
Yeah, I mean, Carlos, it's very hard for me personally, because my favorite WEC fighter before the WEC was bought was Carlos Condit. And when he come over, and like when he beat Rory McDonald in that late stoppage, that was a little controversial. And then, you know, he got the rematch with Martin Campman. He lost to Martin Campman in his debut and then rematched Martin Campman later and finally got the win back. But yeah. Carlos Condit, to me, is always one of my top favorites. But I think Chiesa gets it done by second round submission.
I was actually thinking first round submission. You know, I think Condit's going to be way out of his depths in terms of the grappling.
But it would not surprise me one bit if we see the natural born killer come out and put a beating on Chiesa for 3 rounds. That wouldn't surprise me either.
It would surprise me somewhat. Carlos Condit, he's another guy that just doesn't look the same anymore.
He's getting older. It's weird. You know, I'm 24, so I'm a couple of years older than you. And I remember when BJ Penn was smashing Joe Stevenson, Diego Sanchez. And I remember Carlos Condit when he, you know, like I was saying, I remember these guys in their prime. I remember ordering the UFC where he knocked out Dan Hardy, and there's a lot of good memories with Condit, but like you said, some of these legends just need to hang it up sometimes.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, I suppose I never actually thought of that. You know what, I'm 19, you're 24, so there's kind of a 5-year gap. Yeah. So when I think of Carlos Condit and the likes of BJ Penn, I think of them and their poor performances, because they're the performances that I watched live at the edge of my seat. You've been there through the whole journey, so you probably still have this like image of their old capabilities in your head. But capabilities that can still come back at any time. I mean, like with these kind of fighters, we do see like little moments of magic, but they just can't sustain it for the entire 3 rounds.
I don't think it would be a shock to anybody, like if BJ won. Like, you know, BJ, it's still BJ Penn. Like Fedor, even now when he's in Bellator and he's older, he's still Fedor. He still hits hard. He still has that heart and... It's weird, you know, and 5 years, like we were saying, 5 years in MMA years is a long time. Like, think about all that's happened from 2013 to 2018.
Yeah, and that's my time as a fan, essentially.
Yeah, the co-main event, and basically this one is my toughest matchup. It's tough for Carlos and Chiesa, but this one is the toughest. This one I almost don't even want to pick. It's so close, but... Yep. I believe Amanda Nunes will win a decision. Now, here's why. I believe Cyborg is going to come out like Cyborg. Cyborg's going
to...
She's going to win round one. Cyborg has never lost round one, I don't believe. Cyborg's going to win round one. Amanda's got crisp boxing. She's got good cardio. She's got good takedowns. My opinion, the overall difference maker is the takedowns of Nunes. Not to beat her up. She's not going to take Cyborg down and smash her. She's probably not going to take Cyborg down and submit her, but just control her, you know, just hold her down and make her tired. I believe Cyborg is going to win one and possibly three. I believe Amanda is going to win 2, 4, and 5, or maybe 3, 4, and 5. One of those alternates, you know. I believe Cyborg is going to win 2 rounds, and Amanda's going to find a way to win a unanimous decision 48-47.
Really? No, I've got Cyborg. I've also got it by UD. Amanda's too tough to put away, even for Cyborg. But Yeah, I do see this fight going the distance, but I just think it's going to be a domination from Cyborg. She's just too powerful. Like I think once Nunes feels her shots, I think she's just going to back up and be on the back foot the entire time. That's generally what I think is going to happen. Although this is probably the women's fight that I've been most excited for since I can remember, probably just because both of them are so high, so levels ahead anyone else in their division, and now they're fighting each other. But I just think Cyborg's just, you know, levels ahead of everyone in women's MMA. I don't think there's a female fighter on the roster that can beat her.
Yeah, I mean it's hard to pick against Cyborg. Picking against Cyborg is like picking against a sure thing almost. Like when Cyborg fights, yeah, it's almost a sure thing. But
well, to be fair, you could make the same argument that picking against Cyborg is like picking against John Jones.
I was going to mention that too. Yes, but yeah. And I explained this to past guests a couple days ago. I am more confident with Gustafson. You know, we'll get into that. I'm more confident with Gustafson than I am Nunes. I pick them both. I'm going with both underdogs here, and I don't know what the betting line is, but I can guarantee you, John is a favorite, and Cyborg is a favorite. And
yeah, you're right, but they're not favourites as much as you think. Like the odds are relatively even, but I think Jones is only a slight favourite,
which makes a little bit of sense. All the controversy, all the bullshit, but ultimately,
and the bookies will be fearing, you know, Gustafson arguably won the last fight, and he came into that fight a 9-1 underdog. I don't know how that corresponds in the way that you Americans like do your odds making, but. Yeah, but it basically means if you put $10 on them, you're getting $100 back. I mean, it's just crazy.
Yeah, and I rewatched it, and a lot of people on Twitter and other places, they forgot or they got it wrong. A lot of people I seen going around split decision, that their first fight went to a split decision. Their first fight was a unanimous decision. John won,
yeah.
And I had to go back and look at it because, you know, I'd seen so many people tweeting and posting split decision. It was so close. There was two 48-47s and one 49-46, all for yeah. John. And I've got it on DVD. You know, I've watched that 100 times this week. And I honestly thought John won. I thought it was close. I thought
yeah,
John,
me too.
I thought John me won 48-47, but it was his toughest fight, so definitely.
Yeah.
But
yeah, I had 3-2 in favor of Jones.
Yeah, same here. But
it looked to me like Gustafson really faded towards the end, like. Towards the fourth and fifth round, he couldn't maintain the same level of output. Yeah, he needs to be very careful. Like, I think in this fight, we're going to see a very, very cautious first two rounds from both of them, and then it's going to be a three-round war once they both know they've got enough in the tank.
But then, referring back to that first fight too, Gustafson didn't look scared. Like, if you go back to John Jones versus Chael Sonnen, John Jones versus Rampage, They were hesitant. They were, you know, that's John Jones standing across the cage. He's got an 84.5-inch reach. He's undefeated. He's a monster. And Gustafson, you know, like at the weigh-ins yesterday, he was still-faced. He wasn't emotional. He wasn't angry. He didn't, you know what I mean? Like somebody like Conor,
yeah.
He gets emotional and his emotions get the best of him and he screams and he smacks your hand. Gustafson was calm and still-faced and just... I believe Gustafson is going to win probably by decision because I can't see him beating John. But I think Gustafson is relatively going to make it, and hear me out, I think Gustafson's going to make it look relatively easy. Meaning, I think John is going to win one of the five rounds.
John, really? That's interesting. Another interesting point. It's always like kind of diving into the psychology of the fighters. But did you notice that at the ceremonial weigh-ins, John Jones wouldn't make eye contact with Gustafson? I found that really odd.
He never has, though. Like, if you go back and watch, he did it for DC, really. And
he did it for DC.
I went.
No, he did not do. I think he did it for Shogun as well, because he like briefly headbutted him.
He turned his back. Yeah. I went back and looked at that myself because he. He's always kind of done that. And then the first fight, when they fought in Canada the first time, he didn't look Gustafson in the eye. He looked down at him. It's kind of, you know, John's thing. You know, he don't... John, and I'd love to get your take on, you know, all the steroid and all this. Do you believe you saw it? First of all, do you believe you saw the story? And I don't. I believe he was cheating again and got caught. I'm sure you know Frank Mir. Frank Mir's story. He tested positive for the same amount of turinabol. And they've suspended him for 2 years. And Frank even asked them, is there any way that this was in my system for a past use? They said, nope, not possible. Tom Lawler tested positive for the same amount. They suspended him two years.
He got 2 years, too.
And then got fired. He got let go after that. It's just, and they said that, first, when you see the embedded series, when Dana comes up to Gustafson and tells him that he tested positive, that all that, he says that all of his tests are negative. He never failed. And then you see Jeff Nowinski on the JRE, Joe Rogan Experience, and he tells Joe, well, he had a positive test in August. He had a positive test in September. He had a positive test in December. So his levels went from like 9 picograms to 50. Then they dropped to 30. And then they went up. It's like they're dropping and going up and going down. Do you personally believe USADA and Jeff Nowinski and Dana, or do you call bullshit like me?
Well, it's so hard because, you know, like I'm not educated enough. You know, Jeff Nowinski, you know, he's working alongside scientists. But it doesn't mean that we should particularly believe everything we say. But my kind of take on the whole thing is I think John Jones has cheated. I think he's intentionally cheated for a long time. But during this camp, I think after he faced the 15-month suspension, I think he's been clean for the duration of this camp. Now, if you look into the science of it, and like John has told you himself, it's long-term metabolites that they've found. But because they're long-term metabolites, that means that they're still having an effect from the research I've done anyway. So yeah, I believe he's not using currently. I believe he's not used for the past 6 months or so since the DC suspension, but I believe he has been a user since his second or third fight in the UFC.
He said that he has never taken performance enhancing
drugs.
No.
When he kind of stood up in the court of law under oath and says he has never intentionally taken performance enhancing drugs, I think that is a straight up lie. There's no way that the level of substance that was found in his system last August and last May, there was no way that the levels of that substance could be taken accidentally. No way.
And we're 18 months later. This is 18 months. So that just by telling you, and I've referred this to, like if I just was like, hey, John, I got fired from my job, and they tested me, and they told me I tested positive for Tarenabol, but the last time I took Tarenabol was 18 months ago. You would call me a bullshit liar, you know? Like 18 months, if somebody told you and you didn't know that something stays in your system for 18 months, that's a long time. It's kind of unbelievable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I suppose I kind of buy into that argument, but then I also buy into the argument that, you know, like there's people that are far more educated and what can stay in the human body than what I can. Yeah, I'm no expert. So like I've seen a lot of people on Twitter become scientists overnight and try and prove and disprove and get into molecular biology just for the sake of this story. Like I don't think it's really in any of our places to do that unless we're educated to do so. But either way, John's original suspension for when he did confirmed, we know there's proof of that he did digest, you know, there was digestion of Tarenabol. He should have received far more than a 15-month suspension because that was also his second time that he tested positive for performance enhancing drugs. So really, this fight shouldn't be going ahead whether he tested positive this time or not, in my opinion.
Yeah, so, and Gustafson was in a tough position, you know, what's he going to say no and not fight? He's already there, he's already ready, of course he's going to fight. But they're saying that he hasn't took anything, USADA, not the UFC, not John. John said he's innocent. John said he's never done anything wrong, if you ask John. But
USADA say that he have, but there's no evidence of new ingestion.
Yeah, they're saying the last time that he did was in July of 2017 when the DC... Yeah. It's just so hard to believe, and the only thing we have to go off of that's relatable is the Frank Mir case and the Tom Lawler case, and both of them situations, specifically Frank, because Frank's tested for the same metabolite, same number, and he even asked them, is there any way at all, because remember he said that he went to Australia and had kangaroo meat, and everybody made fun of him for that. But he was just trying to find some way that it was in there. And they said, there's no way that this has been in your system that long. It doesn't work like that. And I actually had a few people who know their shit about steroids reach out to me. And they said that we don't believe that that's how... They said that's not how steroids work.
Right, I see. Yeah, like I say, like I don't want to comment on the science of it. Because I think everyone's just making themselves look stupid by... But by trying to learn like a whole 4 years, 4 year diploma in biology overnight, like I don't think that's possible. I think the only thing we know for certain is that John Jones has been a cheater. He's been a cheater for a long time. And even if he is still, even if he is, has stopped cheating now, the effects of all his years of performance enhancing drugs are still with him. He's still feeling the benefits of them. So in my eyes, he's a cheat whether he's been using in the last 6 months or not. The kind of recency of his ingestion, it doesn't really make a difference to me. You know, I want him to lose because I'm against PEDs in the sport, and he's clearly been guilty of that at some point within the last few years.
And I don't know if you don't follow American football, but he's got two brothers who are both in the NFL, and both of, if there's one place in America, in the U.S. where you can get the best steroids money can buy, it's the National Football League. The NFL has the best
steroids. Is that right?
The best steroids, because think about it, you know, you've got 350-pound linebackers running into each other going full speed, you know? They want to be big and fast, strong. So, and it, both of his brothers have tested positive for steroids. That doesn't mean anything, but it's fishy. Like, if me and
you... No, it does. Yeah.
If me and your brothers and I test positive and then you test positive, it's going to make them look like we were doing them together, you know? And
Totally.
John's had
access... It's just human nature to make those connections.
Yeah, John has had access to the best steroids money can buy.
Interestingly, I'll need to go read up about John Jones' brother's case because I hadn't heard of that before, but was it the same substance that they were found? Because, you know, if it was the same substance, that would... I mean, there must be a connection in that.
I don't know right
sense.
Off the top of my head the substance, but I do know that both of them have been busted for performance-enhancing drugs. I'll have to look. One of them's Chandler, and I can't think of the other one's name, but they've both been to Super Bowls. They're freak athletes. You know, that whole family's really big guys and muscle-bound athletic guys, but both of them have tested positive, and you can't say the people who say it has no... There's really people that believe that John Jones has never done steroids.
Yeah, oh, no. Like, John Jones has, I think, one of the most deluded fan bases and audiences in the entirety of the sport. I mean, the people, him and McGregor have a delusional fan base who will just support everything they do. I mean, you're a fan of McGregor, and you can be a fan of McGregor and you can be a fan of Jones, but you can also pick apart, you know, what they do and their actions and say, although I'm a fan of them, I don't agree with this. But it seems like both of those characters just have an element of their fan base that just... They just can't see past the possibility of these guys doing anything wrong.
Yeah, definitely, especially Connor. And John, I agree. I expected and I predicted, like yesterday or Thursday at the press conference, John's always been cheered. Like, think back to when John fought DC the second time and won, he was cheered and they booed DC. I believe that John was going to get booed. Think about all the tickets, the people, you know, the heartbreak and the heartache you've cost people flying from Sweden, people flying over, and they book hotels and they book, and then it's moved from Vegas to California on 6 days' notice. So I thought that they would boo the shit out of him, and he come out and they cheered him. These dumbass fans actually cheered him. And did you see where he was arguing with that woman reporter? He's like, dude, better journalism. And I actually, it was very... I got mad just watching it, because John...
Yeah, so did I.
John's the cheater.
Because that was good journalism, you know?
Yes.
She's asking the questions on the behalf of the people that everyone wants to know the answer to, you know? Just because she's acting, posing questions that make you have to defend your own... What's been found in your own body. I mean, that's not lazy journalism.
Yeah.
I mean, I think he took that way too far. He was telling her to sit down and he wasn't answering the question. And at one point, Dana White said, John, let her ask the question. I didn't like the way he handled that. The fact that it was a woman as well, you need to have... I don't know. I just really didn't like the way he came across during that question.
And how is that not a bigger thing, you know? Like, if that was anybody else, like, you know how the women movement and the meat, you know how all that shit is right now. How the fuck is that not on the news this morning? You know, he told her to sit down, told her, ask better questions, better journalism. I don't want to talk to you. Are you done?
Next question.
I mean, like, he was being a straight up dickhead to the point to where Dana even told him, hey, John, calm down. And I don't know if you've seen the other one. He was talking to this one guy, and this one reporter asked him, why are the steroids in your system to begin with? And John was like, you're killing my vibe. Goodbye.
See, I quite like it when I see John in that kind of situation where he's getting angry with reporters, because I feel like for a long time John's been, you know, trying to create this persona about him and trying to portray this image of him that he's really innocent and he's respectful and he's a true martial artist. So when I see him in that kind of angry state of mind, I kind of get a bit excited. So I'm like, finally, John's being himself. I mean, he's clearly a bit of a despicable person, but like behind the scenes. So when I see him show that personality, it was like, did you ever see that that thing with DC where they were behind the scenes and he was saying, pussy, are you still there and things? See, I loved it when that came out because I was thinking, this is John being John and people need to see him for who he is. He's not some like lovely, respectful martial artist that respects everyone. He's not anything like that. So I quite like it when we see those bits of John's personality because I'm hoping that eventually that will lead to his own deluded fan base seeing through him.
Because a lot of people, like you said, they cheer him no matter what. Like, he was telling that woman to sit down and people cheered. He was telling, you know, like, people cheer him. And I predicted that they were going to boo him out of the building. It appears that they're going to cheer him no matter what the fuck he does.
Yeah, I don't know how I kind of know how he attracts his fan base just because his style, you know, like Dana White says it best, you know, I think John Jones, you know, from what we've seen so far, he is the greatest talent we've ever seen inside the octagon. He's the best to ever do it. You know, I personally put GSP above him in terms of the GOAT contention. And the only reason I do that is because of the kind of things that have surrounded John Jones' career. I mean, you can't be remembered as the greatest of all time in a martial art that's to do with respect and integrity when you have all this other kind of stuff going on behind the scenes. Like Chael Sonnen said, I think it's a massive asterisk and this is what he's going to be remembered for instead of his fighting. But in terms of talent, I think John Jones is the greatest to ever do it, or is up to this point. It'll be interesting to see how he handles this much controversy as well, because I've got to be honest, you know, when I'm talking about the psychology of fighting again, it doesn't seem like any of this week is phased on whatsoever.
Yeah, he seems confident, and back to the
he's got thick skin.
Back to the steroids too. You know, I believe he was probably, like you said, the second or third fight. I believe he was using back then. You don't just stumble upon something, and you might have. I mean, you might have, but there's a good chance he was using in all of his fights. And outside of the cage, inside of the cage, he's the baddest motherfucker to ever live. He's the greatest.
Yeah, totally.
I personally have Anderson as number one because you can't say it's Anderson John GSP to me, you know, because you can't say Anderson took steroids. Well, so did John. The only person who you could argue to go against up on Anderson is GSP. I don't think you could put.
Yeah, that's why he's the only person who you know clean. Is clean. You know, so I've heard some people trying to say that GSP is a user, but there's no way that GSP is a user. I mean. The guy stands, and the guy's a true martial artist, you know.
Yeah.
I just love his personality, love what he stands for. He's a role model for the sport, and he's what the sport needs, you know. When we're trying to grow the sport and grow the audience of our sport, we kind of need to get rid of those old perceptions of what fighters, cage fighters, are actually like, that they're all aggressive, on steroids, you know, covered in tattoos. I know you have tattoos, I do as well. That's not a knock on it, but.
Yeah.
You know, we need to challenge these stereotypes. I think GSP does that really well because, you know, he's a calm, respectful guy, you know, that travels the world wanting to improve his martial arts at all time. Added to that, you know, he studies paleontology. He's got a really well-rounded personality. I just think all of that in contention with his fighting, in combination with his fighting style and the names he defeated and how he defeated them, I think that's what puts him to the very top of the list and the greatest to ever do it in mixed martial arts, because John Jones and Anderson Silva, for that matter, they both take the martial arts out of mixed martial arts because martial arts is about integrity, honesty, respect, and they have none of that as far as I'm concerned.
It's close. Some people throw Fedor in there too. I don't think Fedor is the greatest.
In my opinion, at the moment, you can't be a true great unless you compete in the UFC or have competed in the UFC at some point. I think that's going to change in maybe 10, 15 years' time. I think in the kind of generation that we've grown up in, to be remembered as a GOAT, you need to be fighting in the premier organization. And Fedor just, he always missed that boat.
So, with all this being said, all the controversy, the drug test, the USADA being moved from Vegas to California, who wins? Who do you want to win, and who do you honestly think is going to win? We can, like you mentioned earlier, I cannot imagine John Jones losing, just like I can't imagine Cyborg losing. But something in me believes that Amanda Nunes and Gustafson are going to find a way to make history.
How many people watch these videos before I say what I'm about to say? Am I going to get loads of angry tweets in from John Jones supporters?
You want Gus to win. I can feel it.
Oh, nothing will make me happier. I think it'll be the happiest moment of 2018 as a year if Gustafson knocks Jones out in the second or the third round. I think Jones is actually going to finish Gus in the third or the fourth. That's what I think will happen. But if Gustafson does get the job done in any way and becomes the new light heavyweight champion, there'll be no one happier than me.
And I also mentioned before we went live that I think this is John Jones' last fight. To me, and it's
Let's talk about that. That's intriguing.
Why
do you think that, and how did you come to that conclusion?
I believe, and this is just me, and Jeff Nowinski talked about, you know, microdosing, that you normally don't microdose with this kind of drug, but that doesn't mean it doesn't happen. You know what microdosing is. You take a little to get a little instead of taking a lot to get a lot, basically.
Yep.
So he took a little bit to get a little bit of an edge. I believe, me personally, Hank, I believe that John Jones has always cheated a little bit. Some more than others, you know, like when he fought DC, he obviously tested positive. So I believe he needs that little confidence. John's always been the best. He's always been undefeated. He's never lost, never been challenged except that one time with Gustafson. And the second fight with DC, the first round was pretty competitive. And John's not quite human, like his shirt said one time. I think John has always needed that little bit of an edge. I believe that he took just a little bit before this fight with Gustafson, and that's why we're going through all this bullshit. I believe he needs that confidence. And I believe when he loses, which I think he will, obviously, I think when they raise Gustafson's hand and they put that belt on him, he's going to be so heartbroken. He's not, that O is going to be gone, which he's already got one, but it was DQ. He's finally going to lose. And John's used to being the man. He's used to being undefeated. I personally think that this is going to crush him. He's got money. You know, we know he's all got money. He's saved money from his fights. Just something in me, and a lot of people said I'm crazy, you know. I think Gus wins. And I said, first of all, when this all broke, I thought the UFC should get rid of John altogether. I mean, he's too much trouble than he's worth. He's the greatest at fighting. But he's the greatest at fucking up, too. So,
totally.
Do you see that? Do you see any way that happens, that this is John Jones' last fight?
No. I think if he does lose, what he's going to do is he's going to chase the trilogy with DC. Because, you know, if he does lose, then people are going to start putting DC in that kind of GOAT contention. So, and he's kind of already pushing for that trilogy. And I think that if John Jones doesn't look as good as the John Jones we've seen before, because he's not on as much steroids or performance enhancing drugs than he was before, I think that'll quite entice DC into the rematch. Because John Jones knows, you know, if he's to fight ever again in the UFC, he cannot go away. He cannot get away with taking anything, or his career is over. There's no way that the UFC and USADA can justify giving him another layoff. There's no way that can happen. So I think if he is somewhat clean, not completely clean, but cleaner before, and he doesn't look like his old self, then I think we'll see DC calling for the trilogy fight.
So
maybe as soon as early next week.
But and another thing I left out too, I believe, because all this is under investigation too, you know, his case with Vegas, they're having a hearing in a couple of
weeks. Yeah, true. So he could face that suspension like next year.
I believe that he's going to test positive after this fight. He's already tested positive. They've got the sample. Vegas can take that sample.
But they have to do one They still have to do the drug test for the weigh-ins that they did yesterday, and they've got to do one just after the fight too, I believe.
But they've already mentioned that we don't know what we're going to do yet. You know, they're going to have a hearing, and I believe win or lose, he's going to get suspended for another. And once you have a third violation, that's got to be
four years.
4 year minimum. And personally, I think.
But then again, his first case, the suspension for that is meant to be a 2 year minimum. And he got away with, 14 months?
Yep. But then the second one, Jeff Davinsky on JRE said that Jones basically snitched. He basically gave them information that they wanted, and they reduced it.
Yeah, totally. I mean, I suppose, you know, if he does put test positive, then that is, when you ask me, is there any scenario that you could see John Jones never fighting again? You know, if he did get handed a 3 or 4 year suspension, I genuinely don't believe we'd see him fight again. Even though he's still young, I think he's only 30 or 31, but I still believe, you know, if he gets suspended for 3 or 4 years, he's going to turn his head to other things, and he's not going to be a fighter anymore.
Yeah, but you get the grasp of what I'm saying, though, you know, about how he...
Do you know what will really annoy me? If John Jones wins tonight and then tests positive next week and gets a 2 year suspension and we end up with a vacant light heavyweight title.
Again.
Because who will it end up with? It'll end up being the winner of Ilir Latifi and Corey Anderson fighting Gustafson for the actual belt.
Yep.
What a
mess that they have. This is probably 2018 was the craziest year in MMA ever. Think about it. Connor, the bus attack. Khabib jumped the Khabib attack after 229. All the they fired, and I'm just, you know, a few off the top of my head. James Gallagher got knocked out. They fired Yair Rodriguez and then brought him back. Connor lost to Khabib. We moved John Jones, DC, John Jones, Gustafson. They moved it, and so much shit has happened this year.
Oh, it's been an amazing year, to be honest. When we look back at it, I think we have, when I'm talking about the perception of sport and the way we need to grow it, I really think this year has set us back a few years in the terms of the everyday person's mind. You know, I think this has really, really damaged the integrity of the sport this year. Specifically the Conor Khabib incident, you know, Conor, the bus attack and Khabib's antics after the fight. That's the biggest fight in UFC yesterday. You know, more people are tuning in. People tuning into a UFC event for the first time ever. And they just make it look like it's thuggery inside a cage with brawls spilling out all over the place. I just really don't think it's the look that our sport should go for. I don't want to see anything like that ever again.
So before we get off here real quick, a lot of people, the whole reason the UFC did this was because they wanted to keep John Jones on the card. That's obvious. They wanted to keep his fight. Because they feel like, and somebody was arguing this to me, that there's the two biggest draws in MMA are Conor McGregor and Jon Jones. Now, I don't know if that's true. It might be. I mean, it sounds right, but it's like Conor should be 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. You know, it's like Conor and then everybody else, basically.
Totally. 100%.
How many pay-per-views does this do? I believe it does 600,000 pay-per-view buys.
Really?
600,000, and they're expecting more. They're expecting 1 million, I believe.
I'm gonna go with 1.1 million.
Oh, I do not think. I don't think it's even gonna get no.
I think all this controversy and the doping and Gustafson wearing an anti-doping t-shirt to the weigh-ins, I think that's only kind of raised the profile of this fight. I think this fight was kind of going under the radar a wee bit. It wasn't being talked about as much as it should have. And now it's maybe been talked about for the wrong reasons, but either way, people are talking about it. I mean, I think this fight is far bigger than it was this time last week.
Oh, 100%. I agree. I mentioned, too, to somebody that we're 2 or 3 weeks out and nobody's even talking about Jones and Gustafson. And then DC... Yeah. If you're Daniel Cormier right now, you're madder than hell. I mean, he tested positive again, basically. I mean, basically, they said that he didn't do anything wrong, but it's very fishy, to say the least. And now DC's having to relinquish his title, and imagine if John wins in a couple of hours, we're going to have John with the belt, and then imagine, like you said, 2 weeks goes by and they suspend him. We're going to have a vacant belt. Ultimately, what could happen is we could ultimately have DC Gustafson again, and DC could win the belt back again.
I don't think DC wants that fight though. I think DC is concerned a lot now about big fights. You know, he wants money fights, and I think that's why he didn't entertain the Jones trilogy, because it does a lot for his legacy, and it also does a lot of pay-per-view buys, so it helps him financially. But I think with DC fighting Gustafsson again, I think there's too little to gain. I mean, he's already beat him. You know, he's already beat him, and he's moved up to a new division and become the champion there. I mean, and the fight didn't do that many numbers. I mean, what's his motivation to move back down and fight, in my opinion, you know, one of the pound for pound greatest fighters in the UFC right now for little money when you've already beat him? I mean, I just don't think it makes no sense for 39-year-old Daniel Cormier.
Unless they entice him with the belt, which, you know, I mean, they. If they dangle that light heavyweight title and say, "Hey, you know, John got stripped again. You have the chance to
win." Do you know what would actually entice DC to take the second fight with Gus Moore? Would be if Gus actually beat Jones. Jones gets suspended, and then DC says, "Jones, you couldn't beat Gus, but I could beat Gus straight after you."
Yeah, that would, and then arguably, I mean, DC beat him once; it was a split decision, but I think DC would probably win again. He'd be my favorite.
Yeah, I totally agree. He'd just be too powerful a wrestler. But yeah, a lot of people haven't talked about the wrestling that's gonna play a massive factor in this fight, because Gustafsson was famously the first person to ever take John Jones down in his UFC career, and I personally think he'll do it again.
And arguably, Gustafsson has laid up. A lot of people talk about how long it's been since John's fight. Gustafsson hasn't fought in longer, you know, than John.
Yeah, it's 18 or 19 month layoff for Gustafsson.
But his last performance against Glover Teixeira, he looked amazing. Oh,
dead, yeah, that was like a walkaway KO, wasn't it?
Yeah,
it was just a flurry of shots, uppercut, and I think it was just
uppercut hook.
Yeah, uppercut hook. Then it was game over, and then I think he just did. Did a little kiss celebration. But yeah, that was in Sweden, was as well, wasn't it?
Yep.
Was that the one where he proposed to his... Oh, that was an amazing moment. You know, I love seeing things like that. Because that's what we need. When I'm talking about the integrity of the sport, I keep banging on about it. But that's the kind of thing that will entice like people to watch it, because it humanizes fighters. It's not just these big bags of meat that like to punch lumps out of each other in a cage.
John, thank you so much, man. This has been a great episode.
Yeah, it's been great, man. I'd miss talking at MMA with you, because I don't know if I said this in my last interview, but most of my friends from Scotland, you know, they're either big, big casual fans or they don't know a single thing about MMA. So yeah, happy to do plenty more of these whenever you want, because yeah, it's always good to chat MMA with you, Hank.
Yes,
top man. Thanks for having me.
And when this is all said and done, tonight or tomorrow, I might message you and... we'll see what happens. We'll see how this night plays out. I believe that we're going to witness history.
Well, do you know what? I'll probably do a reaction video straight after. So if Gustafsson is to win 4-1, then I'm going to say, everyone, head over to Smoke Break MMA's YouTube channel and listen to what Hank said. He called this word for word how this fight was going to go down.
Thank you so much, man. You have a good rest of the day.
Yeah, cheers, mate. You too. Enjoy the fights.
You too.
See you later, big man. All the best.
All right, buddy. I hope you guys enjoyed this interview with John Sloan. Go check him out on Twitter, John Sloan MMA. I'm just playing. See you guys.